Our speaker today is my amazing sister, Melissa Schulz. Melissa is a New York City-based corporate trainer, executive coach, and sexual harassment prevention expert at GrayWolf Consulting. She has worked with a variety of clients in the financial, communications, healthcare, nonprofit, retail, and education sectors. I think that covers possibly every sector there is. Melissa has partnered in the past with the Female Quotient to bring confidence coaching to as many women executives as possible. And she also trains and coaches for No Bully, a nonprofit organization that aims to eradicate bullying and harassment in schools and communities across the country. Today's address is titled The Me Too Movement in Trump's America. Please help me welcome Melissa Schulz to the podium.
Hello, everyone, and happy Women's History Month. I'm so happy to be here. I'm so honored to be here today, and thank you so much for inviting me. As Lily mentioned, my name is Melissa Schulz, and I'm an executive coach and corporate trainer. And what that means is I go into companies, and part of the training, I do many different types of management and leadership training. But part of what I do is go into workplaces and help them figure out how to establish respectful workplace cultures. So I do have to start out by saying that I am going to put out a trigger warning for this content. Given the subject nature of Me Too and the Me Too movement, I might be using some explicit language today. I will be referencing sexual harassment, sexual assault. If this is a topic that triggers you, as it does for many of us, especially women who've lived through our own experiences of this, feel free to grab a friend, sit next to someone you know and trust and love, feel free to hold someone's hand, and if you feel the need to leave the room at any time because you're feeling emotional or triggered, that's okay too. Do whatever you need to do to keep yourself safe, and I will not take it personally. I wanted to also start out with a little panel, and the panel is going to be a very simple thing. I will need 5 or 6 volunteers. This will only take 3 minutes. We are live streaming today's talk, but we'll turn the live stream off for the panel discussion. And the panel discussion, there is some criteria, as you can see. So I need people, 5 or 6 people who identify as female. You have to have worked outside the home for at least 5 years at some point in your life. You have to be comfortable answering a few personal questions in front of the whole group. Now, keep in mind, I'm going to be on the panel with you, so I'm not going to ask any questions of you that I won't answer myself. And lastly, you have to feel comfortable standing up and sitting down a couple of times over the course of 3 minutes. So can I get 5 or 6 volunteers to come up and join me on the panel? Who's going to be brave? Yay! Thank you. Come on up, ladies.
Test. And do you want to manage the mic?
Does anyone else want to join us? Anyone else dying to join? Okay, then I'm going to just grab one more chair. Okay, so we're going to play a little game. It's pretty easy. I ask a question. Everyone starts standing up. Thank you. Everyone start by standing up on our panel, not the audience, just our panel. And I'm going to ask a question, and you just answer the question honestly. So the first question is, sit down if you've ever been to the Grand Canyon. Okay, so you two have never been to the Grand Canyon, but everyone else has. Okay, we have an excellent panel. Thank you. Everyone stand up, and we're going to do this a few times. The next question is a little bit harder. Sit down if you've ever heard a sexist or inappropriate joke in the workplace. Okay, everyone stand up again. Sit down if you've ever had a man in the workplace comment.
Her to talk to someone else.
but it stayed with her for 10 years. She had wished that she had responded differently. And what she wishes she could have said to this 13-year-old girl was, me too. She wanted her to know she wasn't alone in her experience, that this is something that many girls and women have faced. So fast forward 10 years, and the presidential election is happening. And many women reported feeling like the climate for women had changed in the country, right? And we have a woman running for president, and things seem to be getting better and better for women, right? And then Donald Trump is the candidate, one of the candidates. And during the presidential election, many women reported feeling triggered. We know that more than 13 women came forward as he was running for office and shared their own stories about how he had sexually harassed them or sexually assaulted them. You know, everyone by now has heard the famous quote, "You can grab them by the pussy." He said other very disrespectful things about women during the election. And this set the stage for women wanting to speak out. I think it was the tipping point in this country. Because he didn't just, there were no consequences for him, right? He went on to become the president of the United States despite his disrespectful behavior towards 50% of our population. So the harassment was so public, it was so over the top, we reached a tipping point. Fast forward to months, not quite a year after the election, all of a sudden there's a very public sexual abuse scandal. Allegations came out against Harvey Weinstein, one of the biggest, most successful Hollywood moguls in the country, in the world, you could say. And a celebrity, Alyssa Milano, posted on social media a hashtag. Does everyone know what a hashtag is? It's the pound sign, and it's used in social media for social media users to track and follow and join in conversations. And Alyssa Milano posted, after the Harvey Weinstein allegations came out, she encouraged women to use the Me Too hashtag and share their own stories. And wow, did women follow. Within days, millions, not hundreds, not thousands, millions of women all over the world had posted sometimes just two words, me too, on social media. And this happened across all industries. So all of a sudden, men, not just in Hollywood, and not just in some of the more prominent professions in corporate America, healthcare, education, academia, but also the military, politics, medicine, sports, and even low-wage workers. So farm workers who were making less than minimum wage started gathering and talking about their own Me Too experiences. So this leaves us all wondering, right? Have things gotten better for women in the workplace today? These are some of the questions we're going to talk about today. Are the roles different for men and women? Is there anything we can do about this, sexual harassment in the culture? What's being done? And how can we all feel empowered and accountable? So everyone should have gotten a little worksheet. If you don't have one, raise your hand, and Caroline or Lily can bring one around. I think we have some people in the back row. I want you to use today's session to think about what you can do differently. And I think that question before our session started was a great thought provoker of how we can all change this problem in our culture. So to really understand sexual harassment in the workplace, I want to go back to the late 1950s, early 60s. How many of you were working outside the home in the late 50s or 60s? Show of hands. Okay, quite a few of you. So can someone tell me what the average worker looked like in 1959, let's say? Male. What color was his skin? White. Yes, the average male worker in the late 50s in the US was a white man. He wore a suit to work. He had 2.5 children. We don't know what happened to the other 0.5 of a child. But demographically, that was what he looked like. And if you were a woman showing up for a job interview in even 1963, you were told, if you showed up for a position that was a male position, you were told, I'm sorry, but this is a job for a man. So the government, to counteract the discrimination that was happening, and by the way, it wasn't just gender discrimination, right? It was race discrimination, it was religious discrimination, anything, you name it. If you showed up for an interview in a wheelchair, well, you couldn't show up for an interview in a wheelchair because there was no disability laws back then that forced companies to make it accessible for you to come to an interview in a wheelchair. So Congress passed the biggest employment law we have on the records, and the United States has more employment laws than any other country in the world. They passed the Civil Rights Act of 1964. It's also referred to as Title VII, so if you've heard it referred to as Title VII, this might sound familiar to you. And it basically said that you can't discriminate based on race, color, sex, religion, national origin, disability, and for the purpose of today, we're going to focus just on sexual harassment because it's so linked to the Me Too movement. So the definition, and harassment is a legal term. The EEOC defines sexual harassment as unwelcome sexual advances, request for sexual favors, and other verbal or physical conduct of a sexual nature. However, it does not have to be of a sexual nature. So this could also include offensive remarks about a person's sex. It can be something like pregnancy discrimination, because only women get pregnant. That's seen as gender discrimination. And there are two types of sexual harassment. So the first type is quid pro quo. Are there any Latin scholars here? Not my mom, you're not allowed to answer. Are there any other Latin scholars here? There we go. Quid pro quo, anyone want to yell out what it means? This for that. Thank you, Latin scholar in the back. So quid pro quo means this for that. If you come to my hotel room, you'll have a chance to be in my next movie. If you go on a date with me, I'll put in a good word to the boss. If you sleep with me, you'll get a promotion or a raise. This is quid pro quo. Quid pro quo accounts for only 5% of all sexual harassment cases, but it's the type of sexual harassment that gets the most media attention. And this was the Harvey Weinstein example, right? Quid pro quo. With quid pro quo, if you can prove that it happened even once, you win your case. But again, this is only 5% of sexual harassment cases. So what are the other 95% of sexual harassment cases? They're hostile work environment cases. And hostile work environment, there has to be a pattern of abuse. And it has to be bad enough so that one of the big myths of sexual harassment is, well, now these women just make a claim against some man and he gets fired and they get millions of dollars. Absolutely not true. In fact, These are statistics from the EEOC in 2017. You can go to the EEOC's website and see statistics for each year from 2012 at least, and the new results for 2018 just came out. So in 52% of cases, there's no reasonable cause found. Only 11% of cases actually end in settlements. That's this red chunk right here. So we can look at this data and know that sexual harassment hostile work environment sexual harassment cases are extremely hard to prove. And not just that, but only 14% of women ever report. And why do you think most women don't report sexual harassment? What's that? Lose their job, fear of retaliation. Lose their job, and we've seen this. In fact, the EEOC gets thousands of complaints each year about how women, and there was just a story in the New York Times yesterday about a woman in the financial sector who got fired, she claims, because she spoke out against sexual harassment. So what is the solution? What do we do about this? One may say, have more training. We need sexual harassment prevention training in corporate America and in the world at large. And actually, three states, as of last fall, three states had mandated sexual harassment prevention training. California, Connecticut, and Maine. New York just joined those three states in mandating sexual harassment prevention. So as of October 9th, 2018, it's now mandatory in New York. But sadly, there's a lot of research to suggest that some types, most types, of sexual harassment prevention training doesn't actually stop sexual harassment. Typically, it's done as compliance training to help employers get off the hook. If there's a lawsuit against them, they can say, well, look, in March of this year, we hired a company to come in and do sexual harassment training. So let's get back to our original question. Are things improving for women? And something that came up in my group discussion prior to the session by my brother-in-law, if I may call you out, Scott, on this, it's a true thing that what Me Too, one of the backlashes against the Me Too movement is that it has made some men very afraid to speak, to engage with women. So leanin.org, a big organization looking at these issues, did a survey and found that the number of male managers who are now saying they do not want to mentor women has tripled. A lot of male managers report feeling uncomfortable working alone with women. And this is a problem, because if we can't have a seat at the table, we're missing out on opportunities. If we're working in male-dominated industries where men are afraid to mentor us, we're not going to have the mentorship that we need to rise the ranks in some of these very male-dominated industries. So again, you know, has Me Too helped? We have trainings. We have laws on the books. For over 50 years, sexual harassment has been illegal, and yet it still happens, right? So women are still being harassed. Harassers don't see themselves as the problem. In fact, sometimes they even get elected after their public displays of harassment. So what is the answer? What can we do? How can we change this dynamic? Well, I would argue that Me Too is starting to do that. So Me Too is starting to have the conversation, and sexual harassment is a culture issue. Culture is as much about what we encourage as it is about what we permit. So what Me Too has helped is, what Me Too has enabled is us to have these conversations. Yes, sometimes they're difficult, sometimes they're uncomfortable, but we're having the discussion and we're shining a light on this ugly truth that has existed in the workforce no matter where you are, no matter whether you're working in a big multi-million dollar job on Wall Street or you're a farm worker, a migrant worker, or a minimum wage worker at McDonald's. So I want us all to do a little exercise. It's an easy little exercise. Just cross your arms any way that feels comfortable to you. Some of you are already crossed. Okay, and now what I want you to do is switch arms, but you have to mirror exactly how your arms are crossed right now. So like I have one fingers on top here and a hand tucked. Switch arms, but mirror the exact way that you did that. Some of you have given up already. Okay, so, and some of you figured it out. How does that feel? Hard? A little uncomfortable? A lot uncomfortable for some of you, maybe excruciating? Okay, well this is, and you can take your arms or go back to your natural position. This is what change is. Change is uncomfortable. Change is never easy. We're creatures of habit, right? Change is hard. So thinking about change, we know we have to change the culture. We know that change is hard. So where do we start? How can we change? First step, creating awareness. So that's what the Me Too movement has done so brilliantly. Right? We know, and as you saw here on our panel, that Women face sexual harassment. 81% of women, maybe that number's even higher. I don't know a single woman who hasn't faced some kind of harassment or discrimination because of her gender at any point in her life. The other good thing that's happening is the EEOC is reporting a year-over-year increase in sexual harassment suits. Now, you can say, that's a bad thing, because doesn't that mean it's happening more often? No, the research actually shows that this problem has been going on forever. What's happening now is there's more awareness about it. And yes, again, laws can help, and trainings in some cases can help, but what else can we do? What can we do as everyday citizens? Are the roles going to be different for men and women? Do men have a different place in the movement than women do? So the first thing I want to talk about is one of the things I feel like has been misinterpreted in the Me Too movement. And that's the misinterpretation that Me Too is a movement to bring men down. Me Too was never intended to bring men down. Me Too was intended to show the pervasiveness of the problem and let women rise up. Now, we often have disagreements, right, with people who may not see our point of view, and I would imagine that because this is ethical culture, we have a fairly progressive bunch in this room and a lot of open minds, right? Anyone here feel like closed-minded and ignorant? Yeah, I didn't think so. Oh, one, okay, there's one guy in the back. I'll talk to you separately afterwards. But even with our one friend in the back there, can we think about how we have these conversations with people? Can we think about how we bring men with us and make them our allies? Because men, my goodness, we need you. We need you, we need you, we need you as our allies. So instead of speaking to someone like, what were you thinking saying that horrible sexist joke just now, right? Instead of blaming and shaming and criticizing, maybe there's a different way I can get to Bart and convince him and evoke empathy in him. This is where we've had ton of success in the organization I do coaching and training for called No Bully. We go into schools and we talk to bullies and we get them to see empathy for their target, for their victims. And it's game changing. No Bully has a 95% success rate in the schools we go into at eradicating bullying. But it's not just a training, it's not just a talk, it's not just a one-off, it's not just a hashtag, and it's not lip service. It has to be a culture change. It has to be a group coming together to say, no, you know, this is not okay, we're not gonna do it this way anymore. So let's talk about behaviors and actions for women, what we can do as women to help the movement. Well, the first thing, let's believe women, hear their stories, empower others to speak up. Of course, safety first, but if you know a woman who has been harassed or sexually assaulted, sexually abused, it is good to tell her, no matter what you decide, I'm gonna be there for you and support you. Be aware of your own unconscious bias. And I could spend the next 5 hours talking about unconscious bias. We don't have time for that, but in your resource list, there's an amazing video, TED Talk, by a woman, her name is Verne Myers, on unconscious bias. I would recommend everyone watches that video to understand unconscious bias and become aware of your own unconscious bias. And what Verne says is, in order to overcome unconscious bias, we have to lean into it. We have to recognize it. I'm a feminist. I've been a self-described feminist since I was 15 years old. Do I still have internalized sexism? Absolutely. Am I aware of it? Yes. And that awareness can go a long way. Avoid male bashing. Again, anything negative said about men, like men are all dogs, and the typical male bashing that we hear, you can interrupt that too. Instead of bashing men, let's bash the negative behavior that we don't like. Let's say, not Bart, you're a dog, you're a jerk, you're a pig, whatever word you want to use. I'm so sorry for picking on you, but you're in the front row. But instead of all that, can we say, I didn't like that sexist remark you made? You might not realize that joke was sexist, but it is. Interrupt the behavior. Be an advocate for women and girls. Avoid gossiping and speaking negatively about other women. Avoid words like bitch, which really is a sexist word. Be in touch with that. Push for equal representation. So get more women elected. Get more women on the board. Get more women speaking up here at Ethical every Sunday. Think about and role play how you'll respond if you experience a Me Too moment, or if you observe sexual harassment anywhere. You're at McDonald's and you observe, and really if you observe any sort of discrimination, so racial discrimination, think about, be ready to interrupt it. And the only way you're going to do that is if you role play it, because this is one trend that plays out in Me Too over and over and over again. We hear women saying that in the moment they wanted to do something, including Tarana Burke, right? When that woman confided in her that she had been sexually assaulted and abused, she wanted to be able to say something to her, but she was so caught off guard, she didn't know what to do. So role play, what would you do if you're in that situation? What do you do if you're online in Starbucks and you see harassment happening? How are you going to interrupt that behavior? If you've been the victim of sexual harassment, sexual assault, sexual violence, either at work or elsewhere in your life, there's so much great resource out there. There are hotlines you can call. You can Google this and get a ton of great resource. Talk to someone about it. Talk to a therapist about it. Remember that it was never your fault. Any sort of sexual harassment we face as women, it is not our fault. It is not okay. And then lastly, and we'll spend a little bit of time about how we talk to young people to help them know what consent is and to teach them about respecting everyone. So now let's go to you guys. Any guys nervous about this next slide? Behave, Tony, a little nervous there? Okay, so let's talk about behaviors and actions for men to be great allies. And I'm so fortunate today that I have three of my most wonderful male allies here today. I have my dad, who was my very first male ally. I have my husband, my partner, Tony Steiker, who supports me every day and listened to me cry for hours and hours during the whole Brett Kavanaugh hearing, because it was triggering so many of my own experiences and I was so angry at the injustice. And then I have a former colleague of mine, Tony Gomes, who was my creative director and is a big champion of women at the very huge global ad agency where he works in a very senior position. And we worked together for 7 years, and Tony was always a great advocate, not just for me, but all of the women on his team. So number one, believe women. Hear their stories. Ask them about their experiences. Ask your wife, your sister, your niece, your mom, your cousin. Ask them, have they ever experienced Me Too? And be prepared to listen to them. And when I say listen, this does not mean you get angry, I'll go and I'll kill him. We don't need you to protect us. We don't need you to fix it. We just want you to listen. Just listen to our stories. Let us cry if we need to cry. If you feel the need to say anything at all, you can say, I'm so sorry that that happened to you. That's a good thing to say when you're hearing a woman's Me Too story. Be aware of your own unconscious bias. Again, guys, you all carry it. You all carry sexism. How could you not? You're born as men in this society, which is a sexist society. So talk to other men about that. I wouldn't recommend you talk to your wife about all your unconscious bias. She may not appreciate that, but talk to other guys about where you see your own bias playing out. Avoid blaming, shaming, and criticizing yourself for your past mistakes. What is in the past is in the past. That doesn't mean you don't have an opportunity to apologize. There's always an opportunity to apologize. I'm really sorry I made that sexist joke. I'm really sorry I commented on what you were wearing when you told me about that bad experience you had on the street and you were catcalled. Be an advocate for women and girls. Push for equal representation. And again, I know you're doing so many of these things, right? We changed the House. Let's give a big round of applause for more women in political power, thanks to our male allies. Be an empowered upstander. So again, learn how to interrupt and be ready. Practice, role play how you're going to interrupt racism, sexism, homophobia. Be aware about how often you make comments on a woman or girl's physical appearance, and how often you physically touch girls or women without their consent. It's one of those little subtle things that you might not even realize you're doing it, but that can be something just to look at. Ask women, especially those women closest to you, but also women, you know, who you work closely with at your job, outside the home, and in the home, how you can be a great ally for them. And then I do want to spend a little bit of time talking about how we talk to our young people. So this is my daughter, Cyan. She's 5.5 years old. You might have seen her running circles around here earlier. I have a little story to tell about when Cyan and I, this past fall, were on a playground in Brooklyn, New York, where we live. And she was climbed up to the top of the slide and was about to go down, and two boys came up behind her and they pushed her really hard. She fell off the slide and injured her ankle and ran over to me very upset. And she said, "Mommy, two boys pushed me down the slide and I fell and I hurt myself." We were with her friend and her friend's babysitter. And the friend's babysitter, without even thinking — this is a woman — without even thinking, said to her, "Oh, that's just what boys do. That's boys being boys. That means they like you." What kind of message is this sending to a 5-year-old girl, that when boys like you, they're gonna hurt you? So I stopped for a moment, and my gut wanted to blame, shame, and criticize, right? But I had to think, right? Power of influence. This is a teachable moment for this babysitter who babysits another 5-year-old girl. So I just interrupted that and I said, "Nope, that actually is not true. When boys like you, they don't do hurtful things to you. That's not okay, it's disrespectful." And I think she got the message. My daughter certainly got the message. And there are other things, boundaries with children. So, you know, she wanted to get her ears pierced, and we talked about how it's your body, it's your choice, you get to make that decision. Cyan wanted to know why I got my ears pierced when I was a baby, but we didn't pierce her ears when she was a baby. Well, we wanted it to be your choice because it's your body. This actually has backfired on us because she says repeatedly when we say get in the bathtub, she says, "Mom, my body, my choice, I'm not doing it." My husband there is laughing because he knows it's true. But these are the things. We send our children mixed messages, right? Forcing our kids to hug — go hug your Aunt Samantha, whoever, right? They may not want to hug relatives. They may not want to hug your friends. But we invade their boundaries sometimes, well-intentioned, right? No one wants to hurt their child. We're all well-intentioned. But those are the things we can think about. So we have been having conversations with Cyan ever since really she was 3 about consent. And before someone does anything to your body, you have to ask permission. And her male friends do this too. We got together with friends of ours who have a 5-year-old boy, and at the end of the night, he said, "Cyan, can I give you a hug?" And she said, "Yes," and they hugged. And it was the sweetest thing, seeing these 2 5-year-olds do what certain members of our political system haven't yet learned. So we also know there's a great book by Gavin De Becker called The Gift of Fear, that sometimes women in the push to be nice — and many of us, especially those of us over 40, we're socialized to be nice, be ladylike, right? And this keeps us sometimes from speaking out or stopping negative behavior that we're experiencing. And we saw this in Me Too play out as well. So think about just being an advocate every chance you get. I want you also on your worksheet to think about what is just one thing that you can take away from today's session. Whether it's I'm going to send a donation to the Time's Up Legal Fund — they do a lot of legal work with low-wage workers who are being sexually harassed on the job but can't hire expensive attorneys to protect them. It could be I'm going to go home and ask my partner about her Me Too story. It could be a number of things. I'm going to talk to my son about consent. I'm going to talk to my niece about consent. What is one thing you could take away from today's session? And lastly, I do want to leave a couple of minutes for questions. We have a couple of minutes, right? Yes. Okay. Also, I'd encourage you, if anyone thinks of anything a week from now, a month from now, a year from now, 5 years from now, this is my information. You can always reach out to me if you have any questions on this subject matter. I am here and available. And thank you so much for being such an engaging audience. It was such a pleasure to be with you today. Thanks.